Today we're taking a look at the 1982 movie The Beastmaster. I was 8 years old when this movie came out. My parents took me to see it. We thought that it would be a good family adventure. I didn't know what to think of it. I was only 8 years old. This movie scared me pretty good. And I remember going home and not being able to sleep. And one of the reasons for that in particular was the death guards that we're going to take a look at, which deserve their own spotlight because they're just such a completely ridiculous concept. But the movie, which came out in August 20th of 1982, 1 hour and 58 minutes in length, was billed as an action-adventure fantasy. So my parents took us kids to see it, thinking it was going to be a sword and sorcery fantasy type movie about a young boy doing something. Well, we got there and found that it was much more graphic, much more adult than they anticipated. But the movie stars Mark Singer as Dar, the man who can speak to animals and has a way of just kind of telepathically knowing them. And then Tanya Roberts, who is his love interest, who's like a priestess, like a slave girl in the movie. It has a number of other characters. John Amos, who stars Seth, he's a wise man who assists them in the fight. Well, basically, the movie goes through the Jeanne Horde, and it takes you through the characters of the wicked people who are, and it's got a lot of sorcery and magic. And the plot line reads, Dar, the son of a king, is hunted by a priest after his birth, so he is sent to grow up in another family. When he becomes a grown man, his new father is murdered by savages. He discovers that he has the ability to communicate with animals. And after that, Dar begins his quest for revenge in this Conan-like movie. That's actually in the IMDb description that I just read you. It's rated PG, but it actually could have been a PG-13. It did have some adult themes and scenes. Well, let's look at these death guards, because when they get to the Jeanne Horde pyramid, they find these death guards. They're made by taking a man, an unwilling participant, an able-bodied strong man, and they chain him down, and they put spikes on his forearms and through down to his hands and spiked studded leather wear down through his legs, and then they put a big helmet on his head, but not before chaining him down and torturing him, where they put a leech, some kind of erectus letheus, some kind of a leech they never really identify, and frankly I always wanted to know about. Why? Where did they get this plot premise from? Where did they get this ridiculous idea from? The idea of putting a leech down someone's ear. And of course, the boy, one of the young boy who meets Dar, says extreme torture transforms the man into a wild beast. How does that work? Unless there's magic or voodoo or something involved, how does that even work? So this scene here has a man, a no-name actor, who's being tortured, and the one of these Jeanne Horde priests come up and they take the leech and they blow it down his ear. Apparently, do they rupture the eardrum? How do they get it? Otherwise, he would have to be deaf in that ear. If they get it to, I guess they're saying that it's going to eat his brain. And he's not going to have any social skills, so he's basically going to be a primal being. He's just going to be a thing that kills anything it meets. So he's got these spikes strapped on his arms, and so finally he falls unconscious. But for some reason, this goes wrong, and the priest didn't restrain him well enough or something. So the creature wakes up, this man transformed into a wild beast. But they got the helmet locked onto his head and everything. So now he's a monster. Well, what happens? He goes out and he starts chasing the two little Kodo and Poto, the little ferrets that got the keys away from the guards so that they could execute the plot. This had me so scared as a kid because I did not know what to think. These monsters are like just crazy freaky. I didn't know. I wondered if this could even happen. Like, what do you do if you're held down and someone puts a leech in your ear and you can't get it out, and it eats out your brain so that you're mindless and you're basically an attack dog. You're nothing. But the problems that this brought up haunted me as I went to school because I was very scared and I couldn't sleep a few nights. But then I also couldn't make sense of how they thought of this. For instance, why do their eyes turn green? Where do they get the green eyes from? Of course, I later learned that in the production, they actually, this was a suit, and the green eyes were lit up so the actor couldn't see at all. So watch that when you rewatch this, go back and look, and you're going to find out that it wasn't thought out, and they never intended it to be. That's why they're stumbling around in the costume, because the guy, the actors could not see. That's actually, when you rewatch it, it's pretty hilarious. But why would you ever do this? Let's assume you're an evil horde army, and for some reason you want to dominate a town, and you want a perfect attack guard. What would you do? Would you take a person who needs to eat and shit and drink water? What would you do? How would, first of all, that brings up the logistical problems. How would you ever do that? How would you ever get this? These things can't eat, so that means, and they can't drink because of this mask, and they have spikes on their hands, so they can't feed themselves. And they're kept in cages next to each other, locked off until they're needed. How would you get them out? How would they live next to each other? Because they're going to attack anything that moves. So how could you use them in any capacity? They're just going to be constantly hitting. They don't care what kind of pain you put them in. They're going to just charge and go crazy and just attack anything that breathes. So the first thing is, how would you nourish them? Let's say you make a death guard. Let's say it can live 4 days without food and water, assuming they're a healthy, able-bodied individual. Well, now you can't feed them. How do you feed them? So now they have pants on. They're going to shit. They're going to piss. What are you going to do? How are you going to clean that up? Would you want to? That death guard chamber that Dar walks through before he runs into these things, that must have been a stinky-ass place, man, because you can't take care of these things. You can't bathe them. What are you going to do? Knock them out to bathe them? There's really nothing you can do. So ultimately, all the problems, that they should have just left this out. This is one of many things they should have just left out, but I can remember being so scared as a kid because I thought, what if those things get put in my ear? Can a leech in your brain do that? Of course, the answer is it would have no such effect because the areas of your brain that are responsible for primal conduct are actually beneath that. So as the leech ate into your brain, supposedly, it really couldn't eat all of the areas that are responsible for your higher functioning because the brain is not laid out that way. But anyway, so the movie Beastmaster ultimately comes away with a very good grade. It was well respected in theaters at the time, and the character development is there. It's got a meaningful story and a meaningful plot. It brings you along with the action enough to say it's worth the watch. So ultimately, Beastmaster walks away, I'll say, with a good B+, if it's even fair to give it a grade this far out after it's been made. But the Death Guards, no, 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 no. Those have to go.